Okay, so the next talk, which I want to split over part of it, half an hour today and about 1 hour tomorrow, is on creative thinking. What is creative thinking? This is a talk which will draw from different disciplines. I'll try to give examples from many other disciplines, and then I want to dispel this. We want to together, myself and Professor Karmalkar, we want to dispel this idea that creative thinking is a gift and not cannot be developed. We want to emphasize that creative thinking is a skill like any other skill. You can develop and you can help your student to develop creative thinking skill, and that is very, very important when it comes to training a researcher, training a student to do research. Okay, so outline of my talk is I'm going to just touch upon different levels of thinking. All of you know Hortz and Bloom's taxonomy, so I'm not going to spend much time on that, because now that you are into NBA, you have to deal with this Bloom's taxonomy. I'm going to spend some time on what is intelligence, what is the difference between intelligence and creativity. Okay, I'm going to talk to some extent on, is creativity a gift or it's a skill? Okay, what is the observation? What is the observation of experts? How does one develop creative thinking skills? I want to give some examples that how a same thing can be viewed differently. Simple examples that would cut across disciplines. In fact, in my tomorrow's talk, there might be one or two examples are a little more technical and maybe a little difficult for faculty of humanities to follow. But I am hoping that most engineering faculty will be able to cope up with that. learning multiple viewpoints, and what is the role of learning multiple viewpoints with developing creative thinking? How do you encourage your student to develop creative thinking by exposing him or her to multiple viewpoints? What is the role that analogies play in developing creative thinking? Now, this particular slide, all of you probably have seen even today or earlier when you are doing NBA. And so I just want to emphasize here that when you are doing undergraduate or postgraduate teaching, mostly you are dealing with this first three, maybe fourth one. Okay, we rarely go to these levels, creating and evaluating. So these levels are not touched when it comes to undergraduate or even postgraduate courses. These are the levels which are touched when you train a researcher or when you are being trained as a researcher, either of the two. So the process of carrying out research requires a combination of higher order thinking skills, that is critical evaluation and critical thinking, and also creative thinking. Creative thinking is integral part of doing research. How does one develop it? Difference, there is a big difference between being an intelligent person and being a creative person. Okay. Now, are they same? Are intelligent, being an intelligent person, being same? How do you measure intelligence? What is the accepted method of measuring intelligence? IQ. Okay. So let's look at some of the IQs of people who were big scientists and people who had very large, very high IQ. Okay. So, and then let's see whether we can draw some conclusions from that. Let's take IQ test as a basis. Okay. This lady, Marilyn Savant. Marilyn first Savant. Okay. Her IQ, ever highest IQ ever recorded, 228. Okay. So she is probably the most, according to the IQ test, most intelligent person. Her job was to write columns in Parade magazine, which was not necessarily a creative job. I'm not degrading her job. Please don't think that I'm saying something wrong about. She used to, see, in most of these columns, there are these columns, you know, you ask a question and then the person will write to help you out of that situation. So she was a columnist who would write those kind of columns. Okay, so probably very intelligent, but not extremely creative as far as her work was concerned. Arnold Schwarzenegger, all of you know Arnold Schwarzenegger? Yeah. You will not associate him with high intelligence, but his IQ is 135, one of the far above the normal IQ, okay. He's a very, very intelligent person. But of course, the work he does is, he must be using it very intelligent, I mean his intelligence when he is governor of California. But before that, you know, our image of him is this fighter, okay. Yeah. And then we will not say that, you know, he's an example of intelligence, but he has very high IQ. Okay. Richard Feynman. Have you heard of Richard Feynman? Richard Feynman is famous. First of all, he was a Nobel laureate in quantum electrodynamics. He is famous for a different reason. He gave, he taught, when at a time when he received Nobel Prize, he was at that level. He taught undergraduate course on physics, okay, at California Institute of Technology, and his lectures are famous as Feynman lectures in physics. Okay, they are legendary, they are beautiful lectures. He was known, or he is known as the last American genius. Okay, his IQ was 126. Okay, not 228. It is much, much lower than. He was not, if you just use IQ as a criteria, you know, he was not as intelligent as Marilyn Foss Savant, but he was a creative genius. Okay, James Watson. Who was James Watson? Who was awarded Nobel Prize for DNA structure, okay, which has just transformed the way we do biology now. Okay, his IQ was 124. I'm flashing these numbers just to stress that intelligent quotient and creativity are different things. These people have been extremely creative, but if you take intelligent quotient as a measure to measure intelligence, these people are not as intelligent as the toppers in intelligence test. Okay, of course, IQ beyond 120 itself is very high IQ. Okay, maybe average IQ we have is about 110 or something. So what is difference between intelligence and creativity? Intelligence refers to intellectual functioning. It's a test that compares performance with other people, your performance with other people of the same age for who are taking the same test. Same age means same time, same age in the sense of not age group, but same time. This doesn't measure all kinds of skills. It doesn't measure your psychological, maturity. It doesn't measure your creative genius. It tells you how, this is from sources from American Psychological Society. And intelligence in a domain implies, you know, ability to function at a very high level. Okay. Or to perform a function at a very, very high level. That's what intelligence implies. An intelligent person may be able to score very high in an exam. Okay. That doesn't make him very, very creative person. We find this many times, we learn this many times when we hire students for doing PhD. Many of them have scored very high marks. And we find that many of those who are not scored so high marks and who get into our PhD program, they are many times much more creative than those who are scored very high marks. Okay. So creativity is different from answering questions, getting marks. So these people who are done very well in exams, they might be able to function at a very high level in industry. They might be able to do some very complex technological tasks, but not necessarily that they'll be creative. Okay. So an intelligent person can be very rigid and non-creative. Okay, so intelligence and creativity are two different things. And we think that it is very important that we emphasize to all the new students who are getting into research. Okay, they think that you have to be super intelligent to do research. No. You have to develop your creative thinking skills and then... So creativity involves altering a domain, posing new questions. As I said, you have to be a doubting Tom. You have to pose new questions. and coming up with novel approaches to solving the problem. This is, you need, of course, some basic intelligence, say above average intelligence, but you don't have to be super intelligent according to IQ test to do great research. So that is not what is needed. Okay. So research involves creative or productive thinking, and I'm going to give many, many examples in my, just instead of being, I'm going to start from examples from some science. I'm going to move to even one or two examples from poetry, Sanskrit poetry. Then I'm going to go and talk about some examples in my domain, linear algebra. So I'm trying to go and span many, many examples and show that how creativity can be taught to researchers. So generating many alternate and novel approaches to the solve the same problem is the main thing that involves, that is what is meant by creativity. Okay. Apply and synthesize multiple ideas within a domain or across domains. Okay. This is very, very important, that cross-fertilization of different ideas and bring them into, so that is what is needed in being creative. This could be to arrive at a new model, it could be arrive at a new technique, it could be arrive at a new molecule, a new material, or an approach, a tool, you know, that you are proposing a new tool. That could be synthesis of, you know, some multiple tools. Somebody in computer science is working on deep learning tools. Somebody in chemical engineering wants to work on some thermodynamics property estimation. Two people meet, come up with a problem of property estimation using deep learning. You know, it becomes a very, very different kind of a tool. Creative thinking of this kind is what, you know, I recently was present in a review meeting where somebody presented about using neural networks for predicting floods using rainfall data. Okay, so developing neural networks or developing deep learning methods is one thing which is going on in research in computer science and being applied in civil engineering, which is completely a different area. So cross-fertilization is very, very important. Okay, it could be a new approach, device, material, molecule. Okay, now I'm going to begin with examples which are non-technical, and we'll move to technical examples, maybe mostly in the tomorrow's lecture. So here, one example that I want to, first example I'm taking is Pandit Ravi Shankar. See, there are many, 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 many musicians who are accomplished musicians in India. One name that many times stands out is Pandit Ravi Shankar. Do you know why? Because he was able to synthesize, he was able to merge Western classical or Western music tradition with Indian music tradition. He was very, very creative. He created music by merging the two, and he made Indian music, Indian instruments popular in the West. Okay. So that was his contribution. He could harmonize between two different traditions, and that required creativity. So examples of creative thinking. So one of the famous examples, now I'll give you some very, very famous examples of creative thinking. So in the beginning of 20th century, structure of atom was one of the most important problem that was being discussed, and I think it continues to be discussed even now. What is structure of atom? And we have so many exciting discoveries even coming now. It's not a problem that has been solved conclusively. So this, at that time, okay, there was this plum pudding model, you know, where all the J.J. Thomson had proposed this model, where electrons and protons, they form a pudding, you know, and they are uniformly distributed. This was the model, and that couldn't explain some of the results that are known in, that were known in physics that time. And so there was a need to modify, alter that. Okay. Now, altering that model came from a Japanese physicist. Many of us don't know this. It came from a Japanese physicist by the name Nagaoka. Nagaoka, for some reason, he got motivation from planetary system model. That, you know, there is a sun which is at the center, and all the planets are revolving around the sun. And he came up with this model in which there's a nucleus with protons and neutrons at the center, and then electrons are rotating around them. This was just creative genius. He just thought maybe that model will work here. And fortunately, Rutherford further developed this model. Rutherford won, Nobel Prize for this particular discovery. But this planetary model was first proposed by this Japanese physicist. So, which was similar to Nagaoka's planetary model. So, this was a creative genius that he could think that something that works for planetary system would work for a atom, inside an atom. And that led to new discoveries. Of course, that model was refuted later and new models came, and what happened is a history. But thinking that planets and electrons could be behaving in the same way was a creative thinking. Okay, spectroscopy, one of the very nice examples of cross-disciplinary research. Spectroscopy emerged with, you know, there are two people who are credited to that, Bunsen and Kirchhoff, physicist Kirchhoff. Okay, so this has happened somewhere in 1860s or 1870, around that time, when Bunsen and Kirchhoff were university professors in Germany, I think in Heidelberg, maybe the place I'm quoting is wrong, but I think it was Heidelberg, where both of them were colleagues, one in the chemistry department, other in the physics department. We know Bunsen for Bunsen burners. All of us use Bunsen burners. So Bunsen knew that if you hold a chemical in a flame, the color changes. Okay, but he was, and he used to recognize chemicals by just holding them in the flame. Though he didn't know what to do further. Okay, this is where cross-disciplinary thinking came into picture. He mentioned this to his friend Kirchhoff, and Kirchhoff said, okay, let's try to segregate different wavelengths using a prism. Okay, and this mutual discussion, this friendship led to collaboration, rather than saying friendship, this collaboration led to this discovery of science of spectroscopy. Okay, so this particular cross-disciplinary thinking is very, very important in coming up with or training the students with them developing creative thinking. Okay, we have to expose them to not to just one particular small area. We have to expose them, encourage them to attend, interact with other disciplines. Okay, encourage them to attend other presentations, lectures that are being held in the university or in the college on different areas. That will help them. This is another simple example, not of a very famous. This one physics group in a university, they assembled a huge magnet for a research project, and which was highly polished, and some iron powder fell on that magnet. So this physicist did not know what to do, how do you remove this iron powder, and they just called a meeting of, because if they try to remove it, the polishing will get damaged. So they had no clue what to do. Okay, and they called a meeting of all the faculty in the university, and they presented this problem, and to their surprise, a person who came with a solution which was workable was an art teacher. Okay, an art teacher came up with the idea that you can use modeling clay to pick those particles without damaging the surface. Okay, so creative thinking is not just, not just scientists, so-called. Okay, so it is, you have to think out of the box. And you have to develop this habit. It is possible to develop this habit. Okay. So, in the later part of my lecture, I'm going to say that how I can teach a subject differently to encourage creative thinking. Okay. So, there are many, many examples, many, many examples you will find where there are such creative geniuses. But now many of those things we think, oh, that is very obvious. At the time when somebody discovered it, it was not obvious. Okay. Afterwards, we know about it, we have learned about it, so it becomes an obvious thing. Okay. So now, nobody will blink and say, oh, planetary model for what is there? There is a nucleus. Everyone has accepted that. Okay. But at that time when it was proposed, it was a creative thinking. I'm going to give an example. There are two examples. I'll skip this first one. Just flash it through. This is one shloka which I found, which has only two things, ya and a. Okay. And I'm not interested right now in telling about the meaning of this shloka. What fascinated me was that just using two things, ya and a, you know, and breaking it in a different way. They have, there's a book called Wonder that is Sanskrit. So where, you know, there's some meaning to this. Let's not get into the meaning. The point is, using just two things, ya and a, okay, you can create something that has full meaning, was amazing. Okay. This next one which I'm going to show you, which is again example for Sanskrit poetry. Okay. So this is, I'm going to share this presentation with you. So if you're interested in the meaning of this particular verse, we'll be giving you on the last day, we'll give you pen drive with all the presentations, extra materials and everything. So you will be able to see the material. So this looks like any other, there are many such shlokas you might have seen. What is there in this? This is an interesting shloka. This is comes from what is called as Sarvato Bhadra. Okay. See, just read this here. Devaki Ninika Vade Vahika Svasvaka Viha Kaka Re Bhavara Kaka. Okay. You've seen this? Okay. Now go to the next page. This is one of the creative things here. You can read this from anywhere to anywhere. It is the same shloka. See. Devaka Ninika Vade. Devaka Ninika Vade. Yeah, you can see this? See, this is entire shloka. You can read it like this. Yeah? You can read it vertically. You can read it horizontally. You can read it from bottom to top. You can read it from top to bottom. You can see this? It's the same thing. Whichever direction you try to read, you know, it is, well, this is just some little bit of fun. I want to talk about this particular paper. Tomorrow I'll be sharing this paper with you. I just want to alert you about this today. Hard copy I'm going to give you. Hopefully this will create some interest. This one particular paper, okay, which I'm going to share with you, is in the area of biology. Okay. And you might say that, well, biology, most of us are engineers here. Okay. But if I tell you who are the authors of this paper, okay, that might create some interest in reading this paper. Okay. This paper is published in Royal Society Journal. One of the most respected journals, yeah? Royal Society in UK, Royal Society Journal. Okay. This paper is written by 25 school children. This paper is written by 25 school children. Okay. It is a research paper. It's in a journal written by 25 school children. With the help of one university researcher guiding them and their headmaster guiding them. Okay, so what I want to break here is that anybody can do research. It's our curiosity, okay, way to organize, you know, way to look at a problem. That is more important in a scientific manner. Okay, so you don't have to be these. Of course, none of them are Einstein. They are primary school kids, okay, and their research is published in. So you should read it out of curiosity, you know, we are going to give you this paper. Okay. So biology letters. Okay. Children were curious to find out whether the bees can solve puzzles. Okay. Can bees, like human beings, solve puzzles? Right? We are able to, and probably you might have heard this, that bees, when they go for hunting honey, okay, they communicate to each other ki, where which side is the honey and where which direction you fly. And there are all kinds of research is done on. We are very curious people. We want to look into every neighbor's home. Neighbor could be, you know, our neighbor, it could be bees who are collecting honey. So this, the kids were interested in knowing whether, so they were taught to create puzzles for the bees, okay? And so the question they asked in this paper is this: can bees learn to use spatial relationship between colors to figure out which flowers have sugar water, which flowers have salt water? Okay, which flowers have color water, which for, so what they did was, you know, they bought some bees. Nowadays you can go to bee people where they do honey collection, you can buy bees, you know. So they bought bees and they reduced the temperature to below zero. Bees went to sleep. Okay, when the bees went to sleep, they put colored dots on these bees so that they can recognize B1, B2, B3. Okay, and then that they increased the temperature, the bees woke up. Okay, then they started doing this experiment. The experiment was like this. Okay, so they made an arena. So this is that arena. Okay, in this they kept pots of different colors in different spatial arrangements. Okay, and in each pot they kept either sugar water or salt water. Okay, they kept sugar water or salt water. They wanted to study systematically behavior of bees, the school children. Okay, they were, what they used to do is, this is like a plastic perplex, you know, glass arena where they can see what is happening inside. Okay, they will let one bee inside, okay, see where it goes and lands, and then they will remove that bee so that the next bee should not learn from the previous bee. They had taken care of doing all this. Okay, so these kids, they devised very nice scientific experiments to understand whether bees can differentiate between this pattern and this pattern. Okay, they have, you can read the paper. Okay, it is a very, very nice, some 3-4 page paper on biology later. No references are given to this book because they are kids. Okay, and it's an important discovery. The cognitive, see, if you look at it from the cognitive science, it's an important discovery whether animals or creatures of that level, are they able to look at patterns? Okay, and this is the data collected is like this, you know. When they see a bee sitting on a salt water, they'll put a dot. Okay, this is the statistical data collected by the kids. Okay, and this paper is, well, reading assignment, as in we are not going to give you marks or anything. I would encourage you to read this paper. We'll give you hard copy tomorrow. Okay, so the games and puzzles, into bracket experiments, that's what I've written. These are the experiments devised by the kids to scientifically understand cognitive abilities of the bees. Okay, and so anybody can do research. Okay, and if it is good research, it can go to Royal Society Journal. Okay, even with you know, so we have to, that's a remarkable demonstration of insatiable curiosity. Of course, they were helped by a university researcher, and their headmaster, guided them in collecting data, bringing that. But it must be fun, you know, taking one bee, letting it inside, see where it goes, you know. And then one bee should not learn from the other bee. So they had all kinds of, so nice thing. So, this paper has come out recently. This is called as Blackouton Bee Experiment. Blackouton is this country school where this experiment took place. So I'm going to stop here. And I'm going to continue tomorrow. My examples tomorrow are going to be a little more technical. Like I said, I'm going to talk about matrices and say that how matrices or linear regression can be taught in different viewpoints. So I want to continue my talk on creative thinking and research. And yesterday at the end of my talk, I mentioned about this paper, Blackout and Bees, and that's the one which I have shared with you. And go through it when you find time. It's a very, very interesting paper. Don't bother whether you know that you don't know biology. You know, it's written by school kids. Everyone can read it. Okay. The important thing to understand here is the spirit. Okay. So if you have the right spirit, even the kids, even the primary school kids can do meaningful research. Let's move to the part where we left yesterday. So actually what I have shared with you is this paper, Blackout and Bee Experiments. And then also there is one more paper shared with it. Biologists have written a commentary on that paper, which is also one page, okay, explaining what is the relevance of this research in terms of research in biology. Okay, so of course the paper by kids is the way they have done the experiments or the way they designed the games for the bees. Okay, so what is the larger relevance of this has been explained in the companion paper which is attached with that. Okay. So you should read both the papers. The other paper I have shared with you is by Richard Hamming, You and Your Research. It's a very, very interesting paper, and I think you should read it, you should share with your students. It's useful for all. It's useful for those who are doing research, who are guiding research, who want to do research. Okay. So it's something that I keep reading once in a while. It has very, very rich information and insights. Which help in grooming students or even grooming yourself, the way you look at the research problems. Okay, so now let's start with the main theme that I was discussing yesterday. Is creativity a gift or is it a skill? Okay, so that creativity is beyond analysis is a romantic illusion, and we should outgrow this. This Peter Medawar was a Nobel laureate in physiology and medicine. So what he is trying to say is that it's a myth created that creativity is something that is gift. It is something that can be developed, it can be nurtured. Okay. Just like you learn to play cricket, learn to study quantum mechanics, you can learn to be creative. Okay. So it's a skill that can be developed, and you have to outgrow the myth that it is some gift. So it can be developed by practice, okay? And what you need is passionate pursuit and perseverance. This is what you need most, not some, you know, some inspiration and all that is not the correct thing. You need a lot of patience and you need perseverance. Okay? You need to be after some problem, and then slowly, you know, you start getting new ideas. So that is very, very important. It's hard work, not some gift. So creativity is a matter of organizing one's basic skills, and what is most important is your motivation. So I want to take some 2-3 slides about what psychologists say about creativity, and then move on to talk about how one can develop it through teaching postgraduate courses, particularly even senior undergraduate courses, how you can shape them. So Catherine Morris Cox Miles was an American psychologist known for her work on intelligence of the geniuses. What she did was she investigated 301 geniuses born between 1450 to 1850, and she made some interesting conclusions based on the analysis of these geniuses. So she says that all equally intelligent children do not as adult achieve as equal eminence, because the youths who achieve eminence are characterized not by high intellectual traits, just high intellectual traits are not what is needed, but by persistence of motive and effort. You know, you have to have persistence. And confidence in their abilities, and general strength or force of character. So she also stresses that it is not some super intelligence, but it is persistence of motive what matters the most. Cox also highlights seriousness of purpose, that is high level of motivation, and she also says that indomitable persistence and seriousness of purpose are two major factors that lead to people making of a creative genius. Okay, and this is a very important statement by her, that high but not highest intelligence combined with greatest degree of persistence will achieve greater eminence than highest degree of intelligence. So it is not just the intelligence, it is persistence. And probably as faculty, you know, we are witness to many of our students, you know, their careers growing in front of our eyes. Okay, and many times you find that ones who were probably not the best in terms of getting marks in the class, you know, go and do very well afterwards. And that is because, you know, what she says is important. Those who are really motivated with some purpose, they seem to achieve more than, you know, just people who are intelligent. People who are intelligent, they will crack exams, they will, you know, but that is not what is needed to make a creative genius. And then now we will get into some concrete examples from engineering domain, which is what I was promising you yesterday. Before that, just one statement by Einstein, that the mere formulation of a problem is more essential than the solution. Okay, so you should be able to formulate a problem well. That is, you know, most of the work is done once you have done that, which may be merely a matter of the solution, may be merely a matter of mathematical or experimental skill. To raise new questions, new possibilities, to regard old problems from a new angle. Just look at this second thing also. He's not just saying that you should always come up with some new problems. Even to regard an old problem from a different viewpoint, okay, is also, you know, creative, requires creative thinking, requires creative imagination, and marks the real advance in the science. So you could be viewing something from a different viewpoint, and we need to tell this to the students, particularly those who are going to do research, that look, research involves looking at the same thing from multiple viewpoints. Okay, so the use of imagination or original ideas to create something, that is the dictionary meaning, and it is defined as a tendency to generate or recognize ideas, alternatives, possibilities that may be useful in solving problems, communicating with others, and entertaining ourselves or others. In order to be creative, you need to be able to view things in new ways and different perspective. So having different perspective is very, very critical. Okay. Ability to take a fresh look at a problem is very, very important. Okay, which is not part of the undergraduate curriculum. Undergraduate curriculum discourages taking fresh look at the things. You just want them to follow, you know, this is the problem, this is the solution, just see whether you can apply it. Okay, don't think more than that. So it is actually unscientific in some sense. You know, the scientific spirit is, you know, you question. Now, see, creativity is something that is innate ability that we have, and I believe that we don't have to be taught to be creative. Okay. Did you ever have your parents sitting with a grammar book when you were? No. Okay. We pick up language. We pick up language. You know, why do we pick up the language? Can you tell me, why do you pick up the language at that age? And afterwards, learning things become difficult. Of course, there is some theory that, you know, brain doesn't have capability and all that, but all of us learn so many other things, you know, afterwards. Okay, so why do you, what is the reason that we are able to pick up language as a kid and we okay. Yes.
At developing stage, and connections are then hardwired.
Okay. The sensei. I agree with this. Of course, I'm not going to contradict this. But there is one more thing which I find which is important. Okay. When we are, this last sentence which I have written is also, I think, important. When you are a kid, you are not scared of making errors. Okay. Our parents keep correcting, or not only parents, everyone around us keep correcting. Okay. And we keep using words. We don't know what those words mean many times. We just use them. Okay. And then slowly we learn the language. Okay. By auto-correction by many people. And we are not scared of failures. So this is an important thing. You shouldn't be scared of failures. So actually, when you are doing literature review, you are learning a language. You are learning the language of a particular problem. Let's say I am working in heat transfer. Okay, I am learning a language of heat transfer through many people who have worked in that area. Okay, and you are trying to learn from their mistakes, from their experiments, for their trials that they have done. It's a kind of language learning exercise. It is not linear. See, just like the language learning we do as kids is not linear. Reading literature is not a linear process. We sample, then we try to create pictures. Okay, this fellow did this, then you know this idea was extended by the next group, and the third group did this, and then some new idea came up. So we are trying to learn patterns, we are trying to learn language of that particular sub area. Okay, so that is, and when you start doing that, then you start becoming, you know, creative in that area, because you are looking at multiple patterns, and it is exactly like language learning. Okay, so you shouldn't be scared of making mistakes. That is very, very important. I'm going to give now examples which are technical. There are two technical examples. My first example, this example is I have chosen this example because it will cut across all disciplines. Okay. The second one is probably should also cut across all the disciplines, but it might become little more technical. But I think all of us are engineers, so nothing to be scared of that. Okay. Now, what I want to show here is that how one particular problem can be viewed from multiple viewpoints. And it has led to, multiple discoveries, or that is what leads to research. That is the spirit that we have to imbibe in our students. Okay, let's look at this problem of estimating value of pi. And I'm going to show you that so many ways of estimating value of pi, and each one is taking the problem, looking at the problem from a different viewpoint. Okay, one is looking at a problem from geometric viewpoint, other is looking at a problem from calculus, somebody is looking at a problem from, you know, stochastic systems and statistics, somebody is looking at a problem from physics. You can actually estimate the value of pi. So I'm going to give you so many different ways of estimating value of pi. Age-old problem for humans, area of a circle. And even recently I read some news item, some group of scientists have found the value of pi up to some God knows how many decimals. So large number of decimals they have correct value of pi. Let's begin with this, some of this initial. This was Archimedes, or it's also credited to Aryabhatta, estimate of pi. So what they did was they said that perimeter of a circle should be in between perimeter of an inscribing hexagon and a subscribing hexagon. If you take a hexagon which is from outside, and if you take a hexagon which is inside, okay, then it's easy to find perimeter of this, it's easy to find perimeter of this outside one. Okay, you take a mean of that, then this will be, what is the area of a circle? And pi r square, and 2 pi r is the perimeter. Okay, so this should be, the half of this should be equal to, not equal to, should be close to 2 pi. If you take a unit, should be equal to pi. If you take d equal to 1, it will be should be equal to 2 pi. Okay. So if you take d equal to half, then you know it will be equal to pi. So that's what they did, and they came up with a number which is, if you come up, if you use this idea, you come up with a number which is very, very close to the value of pi. They didn't stop here. They went out. So Archimedes repeated this experiment for dodecagon, 12-sided polygon, 24-sided polygon, then 96-sided polygon. He said there is an inscribing polygon and circumscribing polygon, and take half of it, you will get value of pi. If you, so he came up with a value which was pretty close. This value was pretty close, and which is the value we use now in the school books. Okay, 22/7 is the value which we use in the school books. But there was a very, very potent hidden discovery into this. He actually said that a circle can be viewed as a limit of an ever increasing polygon. Okay, limit of an ever increasing number of slices of regular polygon with a fixed perimeter. Okay, actually this is one of the basic ideas from the calculus. Okay, so this is looking at it from a limiting viewpoint. The limit of a inscribing and circumscribing polygons is a circle, and they came up with this idea. The next one I'm going to talk about is completely different way of looking at this problem. Okay, so this is by method of Monte Carlo simulations. Some of you might be familiar with Monte Carlo simulations. Okay, so how do you estimate the value of pi? So this is a simple experiment. There is a YouTube video. You can go and check this video. So this is a board of 2 by 2. Let's say 2 by 2 meters or 2 by 2 foot, whatever you want to say. Okay. And then there is a circle of radius 1, which is drawn inside. Okay, now what I'm going to do is going to play the game of darts. You know darts? You throw the dart and it will, So if you throw a dart, okay. Now what we know is that area of the unit circle to area of the circumscribing square is pi by 4. Yeah, all of you agree to this? Okay, so now there is a simple game that you can ask a child to play. Okay, we start playing darts. Okay, what I'm going to do is when I throw a dart, if it lands inside the circle, I'm putting it blue. If I throw a dart, if it lands outside the circle, I'm going to put it as, yeah. Now a dart, see, I'm not particularly aiming at center of this. I am aiming to throw such that my dart hits the board anywhere. Okay, so there's an equal probability that a dart will hit here or here or here or here. Okay, what is interesting is if you just count the number of darts inside, okay, to total number of darts. If you take a ratio of darts inside the circle to total number of darts thrown, that goes to pi by 4. That ratio goes to pi by 4. Okay, and if you go on throwing more and more darts, okay, it will go to very close to pi by 4. So it's another way of looking at, see, the same problem estimating pi. Okay, one through polygons, other through throwing darts. The third one I'm going to show is even more curious. Is this fine? Yeah? The third one is not so obvious, but again by a game. Now you should go and find out from the net this Buffon's needle experiment. Okay? This is this Buffon, Lord Buffon, was a French aristocrat, and he had he was a lord, he had enough money. One of his favorite hobbies was mathematics. Okay, and one day he was, after his dinner, he was smoking a cigar and the cigar fell, and he had a big room in which there were tiles. Okay. The cigar fell on one of the tiles, and it fell on one of the crossings of between the two. So he asked this question, that if I randomly throw a cigar, what is the chance that it will fall on the horizontal line? It will fall on the horizontal line. Okay, you can show, there is very nice mathematics behind this. You can show that the angle at which it will fall, okay, is a random number, and you can show that the number of crossings of the cigar, or here this is experiment done with matchsticks. You know, you draw four lines with matchstick, throw matchsticks, and the number of times matchsticks cross, okay, these two matchsticks have not crossed the lines, these matchsticks have crossed the lines. If you take a ratio, that ratio is related to pi. Okay, and you can mathematically show this using probability, very simple explanation. Should go and read this out of curiosity. Yet another way of looking at pi. Okay, see, what I want to show here is that we want to tell students that look, same thing being looked at by multiple viewpoints. Buffon's needle experiment, one of the important ways of estimating value of pi, one of the important methods of estimating value of pi. Okay, now are there physicists here? Yeah? So can you use physics to estimate value of pi? Can you use a school physics experiment to estimate the value of pi? I'll give you a balance, okay, simple balance, and then I'm going to ask you to estimate the value of pi. Completely different way of looking at the same problem, estimating value of pi. Okay, now you know, I'm going to talk about a physics experiment that can be used to estimate the value of pi. Okay, clue is here. Can somebody crack? Is pi by 4. We know the ratio of areas is pi by 4. Now, how can you exploit that to get value of pi? Correct. Yes, excellent. This is what is the answer. So, what I would do is take a sheet of metal or paper, whatever. Important thing is take something that has uniform density. Okay, create one piece which is, take a metal sheet of uniform thickness, take a piece of say, you know, something that is 2 by 2. Okay, 2 meters by 2 meters or 2 feet by 2 feet or whatever, and cut a inscribing circle. Okay, take another piece of the same size, weigh the first piece, weigh the second piece, ratio of the weights will give me pi by 4. Ratio of weights will give me pi by 4. So this is yet another way of looking at the same problem. Okay, there's a nice book called you know, pi, biography of a world's most famous mysterious number. Okay, you will find many ways of estimating value of pi in this book. So people have, this is one problem which has fascinated human mind for so many centuries, and there are so many ingenious solutions that have come up to estimate the value of pi, you know. So but this is, before I read this book, I never thought that I could estimate value of pi by weighing two pieces. And that gives you, ratio will give you value of pi. Yeah. So, now how do you develop creative thinking? Now, learning or teaching a subject from the multiple viewpoints, that leads to creative thinking, because then that tells the student that there is no one particular way of looking at a problem. Okay, there are multiple ways of looking at a problem. I'm going to try and do this using something that we use in engineering most commonly, regression. Okay, line fitting. Okay, all of us use line fitting. Yeah, fit a curve. So an example from engineering domain, which will cut across many disciplines, is, before that I just wanted to show this sentence that education is not about learning diverse subject, but about learning diverse ways to learn the same subject. Very nice statement to think about. Okay, I'm going to talk about linear regression. Linear regression is something that we use very, very often, even in undergraduate experiments, to in design. We use all kinds of models. For example, most simplest model all of us know is resistance as a function of temperature. Yeah, R is equal to A plus BT, or specific heat of a gas as a function of temperature. Many such models we use in engineering design. Okay, now what is done is typically you estimate these constants A and B from experimental data. We conduct experiments at different temperatures, okay, T1, T2, T3, and then we collect data for resistances for a particular, say, copper wire or tungsten wire or whatever, and then using this data we fit a model, which is, and by using regression, typically least square fitting. Okay, now least square fitting can be viewed from multiple viewpoints. Yeah, like we did in the PMEC course last week. I conducted a course there and then we talked about regression. So my problem is to fit a line in the data. Most common problem in many engineering disciplines, or even in humanities, in other disciplines where people look at social sciences, people look at trends, of some opinion trends and so on. So there is some output Y, there is some cause X, and then we collect data X1, Y1, X2, Y2, and then we want to fit a line. Okay. Can line fitting be viewed from the multiple viewpoints? I teach that in, we have a course on chemical engineering mathematics for both for undergraduate and for postgraduate, and I try to teach them the same problem from multiple viewpoints. Okay, algebraic viewpoint, geometrical viewpoint, statistical viewpoint. Each one gives a different perspective, and that tells the students that you should be looking at the same thing, okay, from different viewpoints. Formula is same, final value is same, A and B is not going to be different, but what statistics tells, deterministic approach cannot tell, and so on. Okay, so let's look at it. Okay, so we have this problem where we have n equations. So I have collected data. Okay, now this data has errors. When I'm measuring resistance, there's an error in the resistance, and I'm putting that as VI. Okay, VI is the error in the resistance. Okay, and I collect large number of data points. Okay, I cannot use, you might say, well, there are two parameters, and you know, you need two equations to get two parameters. We cannot do that because each measurement of resistance is erroneous. Okay, so this error term appears. Okay, so the number of unknowns is not two, number of unknowns is A, B and VI. VI is the error in the measurement of resistance. Okay, so the total number of unknowns is 2 plus n. Number of equations we have is only n. Okay, number of equations is less than number of unknowns, and solution, no unique solution exists for this problem. Okay, this is a simple thing that we do in all engineering disciplines. In labs, when we ask students to fit a line, nowadays they don't sit and fit a line, they just put it in Excel and say fit. They don't know what is happening behind. Okay, but we should be teaching them. Now, algebraic approach of this problem is the least squares problem. So what we do here in the least squares approach is we want to find out parameters, this A and B, such that sum of the square of errors is as small as possible. Least squares problem. Okay, so I'm going to estimate this theta. Okay, to do that, I'm going to rearrange this I'm going to rearrange these equations. So these are my equations, y1, y2 up to yn. I have this errors in the measurement v1 to vn. These errors are not known. And parameters a and b are not known. So there are n equations. There are n equations, n plus 2 unknowns. Okay. I'm going to arrange this into vector matrix notation. Okay. This connects them. This will connect them to the matrix problem. Okay. So I'm going to rewrite this same problem in terms of vector matrix notation. So this is equation y1 to yn are stacked into one big vector. Okay. This is a matrix. This is a matrix. The first row, the first column is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. See, this is just translation of these equations into this one matrix equation. Yeah? This is translation of this equation into one matrix equation. And now I'm going to use this matrix equation to solve the problem. Okay. So this equation I'm going to translate and write as, let's keep that thing aside. I want to solve the problem of minimizing sum of the square of errors. I want to solve the problem of minimizing sum of the square of errors. And let's say this is V is the error between yi and a plus bzi. Yeah? If I want to minimize, if you want to find out the minimum least square solution for this problem, it turns out, you can check the algebra, it turns out that this least square solution is obtained by A transpose A inverse into A transpose Y. Okay, where A is this matrix that I constructed here. This is the A matrix. Okay, and this is the Y vector. If I take this Y vector and if I take this A matrix, okay, the optimum solution, the least square solution of the parameters is given by this. This is algebraic viewpoint. This is algebraic viewpoint. Next, I'm going to look at the same problem. I ask them to look at the same problem from a geometric viewpoint. So I want to now relate it to something that they have learned in their school projections. Okay. I want to show that, see, if I give you some vector, let's say this is a vector. What is the projection of this vector on this plane here? How do you project? I want to project this vector. Suppose this is the vector from here to here. What is the projection of this vector on this plane? Yeah? A cos theta. Drop a perpendicular. Drop a perpendicular. Once you drop a perpendicular from here to here, okay, you will get, yeah. So you will get the projection of this vector on this plane. This is what we study in school. Okay. Take a point, drop a perpendicular, wherever it hits the plane, that is the shortest distance. Okay. I want to connect this least squares problem, to projection onto a plane. Okay. So now this can be done through geometric viewpoint. You can say that actually y bar I am now defining, which is linear combination of two columns. Okay. So y bar, for those of you who are familiar with matrix algebra, the geometry of the matrix algebra, what you can argue and show them is that actually y bar belongs to the column space of matrix A. Okay, it belongs to the column space of matrix A. So this vector, it lies in the column space of matrix A. A matrix has multiple four spaces associated with it. Column space, row space. Column space is space of space spanned by linear combinations of the columns. All possible linear combinations of the columns of a matrix gives rise to the column space. Okay. So column space. So this particular vector is actually a projection of y. This y is a vector which is outside the plane and y bar is a vector which is lying inside the plane, column space. So this is a geometric viewpoint of the least square problem. Okay. So what you can show is that I'll show you pictorially. I'll skip this. I'll come back to this maths. So what I show them is actually y, capital Y is this vector. Okay, there are two columns of the matrix, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and the other column, x1, x2, x3. These are these two columns. Linear combination of columns only gives rise to this plane. Okay, and this vector is outside the plane, it is not lying inside the plane. That's why there is an error. How do you get, you know, the point of least distance from, or inside the plane from this vector, you know, drop a perpendicular. Okay, and then using algebra, so I will not do the algebra here, you can check the algebra. This is a very nice book by Gilbert Strang, okay, which explains this very, very nicely. So what you can show mathematically is that actually this error between y minus a theta is a vector, error vector is perpendicular to the column vectors, to the column space of A. That means you can show mathematically that this vector is perpendicular to this vector. The least square solution is obtained when this vector is perpendicular. So this is geometric viewpoint of this problem. I go on to teach to the same students, formula is not different, viewpoint is different. Okay, I go on to teach statistical viewpoint. I am not going to do the statistical viewpoint here. That is not the purpose of this course. You can view it from a statistical viewpoint. This book is very good. You know, Generalized Linear Models and its Applications in Engineering by Montgomery. And this talks about the same least squares problem from statistical viewpoint. Okay, so the same problem. So many different interpretations, so many different viewpoints. And each one gives you something different, which the other one is not able to give you. Okay, so this is very, very important to teach. And you can nurture creativity in the students by telling them that, look, same thing being looked at from different viewpoints. And then you now discover a fourth viewpoint, fifth viewpoint, that is research. Okay, that is what has to be told. Okay, analogy. Another thing that helps in nurturing creative spirit is analogy. Okay, so you can use analogies to in your teaching, you can use analogies. Before that, I'm going to give you very, very famous examples of analogy which have led to discoveries in science. So the analogy is used to transfer idea from one domain to other domain. Okay, and if students develop analogical thinking, okay, or as a researchers, those of you who are doing research or intend to do research, if you develop analogical thinking, then that will help you to do very, very effective research. Okay, I'm going to give two examples. One example is Nagaoka's planetary model. It was excellent example of analogical thinking. Okay, he just used analogy and came up with a model which is electrons rotating around the nucleus. Whereas very similar thing can be said about the so-called matter waves which were discovered. So in the beginning of the 20th century, okay, all of you know this is a famous example of analogy. The photon model was proposed by Einstein, okay, and it was later established by Planck. So earlier the wave viewpoint was dominant, which was Maxwell's equation, and a photon viewpoint became dominant after Einstein's introduction of this concept of photons and Max Planck. Okay, so in 1924, de Broglie proposed matter wave. I think all of you have heard of matter wave. If you have not studied matter waves, you have heard of matter waves. Okay, and then he said that even the matter has properties like wave. Okay, and then of course Schrodinger later published the matter wave analog of Maxwell's equation, and that has led to many discoveries. But this matter wave idea has come from analogical thinking. Okay, so actually this is what de Broglie has said, that when I conceived first the basic idea of wave mechanics in 1923-24, I was guided by the aim to perform a real synthesis valid for all particles. If coexistence of the wave and corpuscular aspect that Einstein has introduced for photons in the theory of light. So he was transferring idea from one domain to other domain, and this is analogical thinking. Now, question is, can we Can we teach our students analogical thinking? Okay. If we can do that, then that will help them nurture creative spirit. Okay. And that is what we should do actively in our courses or even while discussing with our research students or PhD students. I'm going to give one example from chemical engineering or mechanical engineering, heat transfer. You know, we teach heat transfer. When students are being taught heat transfer, it is typically in second year or first year. Second year of mechanical or chemical engineering, they are being taught heat transfer. Before that, they have studied Kirchhoff's law and they know circuits. Okay, so what we do is, let's say a flow through a pipe and a heat transfer from inside to outside. Okay, we talk in terms of resistance to heat transfer. And then while teaching this, we also write this equation and show an analogy with the Ohm's law. The heat flow and resistance to flow of heat, okay, that is taught with analogy with Ohm's law, current flow and resistance to flow of current. Okay, so these analogical examples, if we can integrate in our teaching, particularly when you are teaching postgraduate course, that will help them to help the students to develop creativity. So what I want to say here is not, yeah. Okay. Yes. And also that also tells the students that you can use analogy to think about different problems. Yeah. So it is important to highlight this. It's important to, you know, so this is very, very important. So the heat flow is similar to current and delta T is similar to the, you know, voltage difference. Potential, voltage potential, and then you can teach analogous ideas through. So there are some prescriptions here that is for your students and for you and for you should nurture. I'm going to close this. I can go on talking about how to integrate many of these things into your teaching. The main point is if you understand the spirit of this and start structuring your courses. Okay, that will nurture creativity. Okay, then that will help. Defining projects that will nurture creativity is also a very, very nice way of doing it. Give the same problem, ask students to look at it from different viewpoints. Okay, I was about 8-9 years back, I taught in Carnegie Mellon University. There, you know what they had done in a design project course, it was a course project. They had given one problem and made teams. All of them were supposed to solve same problem but using different approaches. And it was amazing to see 25 different solutions to same problem. There were two things that students learn from this. Yeah, one thing, of course, they studied chemical engineering to solve the problem. But second thing is, I can look at the same thing from so many viewpoints. It was fun to watch those projects. Okay, so have an open mind and listen to alternate viewpoints and ideas. Even though they may not match your beliefs, okay, might be against what you think is correct. Acknowledge the areas of common ground with those who hold alternate beliefs. This is very, very important to have an open mind. Learn to have a dialogue with somebody holding completely opposite views without attacking the proponent. Okay. These are very, very important characteristics that a researcher should have if he or she wants to do well in research. You have to be a good listener. You should be able to critique somebody without hurting them. You see, you read review papers or you read introduction of many papers, well-written papers. They will point out mistakes of other groups very, very subtle way, very nicely, without hurting them, without saying that this was not a wrong thing. You know, they will say this was a nice thing, but it could be improved. You know, and then they try to point out the mistake. So it is very, very important to do this if you want to have a research spirit. So create opportunities. What you should do probably in your college, in your lab, in your research group is to create opportunities for mixing, for, you know, I talked about the journal club that we have in our group, okay, where weekly we meet, everyone reads one paper. bigger group, one person gets one paper to read in some 6 months. Okay, you present that paper, you read the paper thoroughly, you present to the group, group just bounces on you, chews you up, and then, you know, all of you together understand the paper. It may not be directly in your research work, might be related, but then your ideas, your, you know, creative thinking expands. So these are the prescriptions to expand creative thinking of your students. Okay, read from other disciplines. What is most important in research? People think that when they have a research idea, they should keep it to your, you know, in their pocket, should not show it to anyone. Okay, discuss, open, be open, answer doubts. In the class, I ask the students, please ask questions which, you know, put me in difficulty. I'm not able to answer. If I'm not able to answer a question, I'll be learning. Okay, so I like those. There are always in the class, there are some 2-3 people, you know, who will, and they, many times you get pained by them. Anything happens, you just raise their hands, or this is not the case. But you know, they are the ones who help us actually to grow. So I tell them that please keep asking questions, you know. So that is very, very good. Okay, so meetings, journal clubs, if you can start this. Okay, develop a habit of writing. So ask the students to write regularly. This is very, very important. Your PhD students, if you are guiding PhD students, please ask them to write conference papers once in a while. You should review that, give them feedback. So that review process is very, very important. This is what will stimulate the creativity. Okay, so in summary, I want to end this here. Maybe we can have some discussion. So as per psychology, creative thinking is not some God's gift. It is a skill that can be developed. It is a skill that can be developed through these activities. Okay, interaction, discussions, seminars, attending seminars, encouraging students to ask doubts, and so on. So this requires strong motivation and passionate pursuit. It is just realigning your existing skills. There is nothing special. Okay. So learning about different ways to solve a problem and visualizing world in terms of analogies. These two are critical things. You should be able to visualize the world in terms of analogies. Okay. And you should learn to solve the same problem in different ways. Okay. If you nurture these skills in your students, okay, they will become good researchers. Okay, you can look at this video also by Professor Karmalkar. Again, as I said in the beginning, this lecture I have prepared in collaboration with Professor Shripad Karmalkar from IIT Madras. He delivered a full week course here in IIT Bombay on Introduction to Research Methodology. Entire course, it consists of many researchers from IIT Bombay. This was video recorded and telecast over many centers all across the country. Okay, so these recordings are available, free downloadable or free viewing at this web page, and you will get a rich source of material here on research for training your students, or if you are beginning your research, it will be very helpful. So thank you, and if you have any questions, I'll be happy to take. Yeah. Yes. Yes. No. But environment is. Yes. But we have to create. Yeah, so that is, see, I'm not here talking about a particular, you know, discovery that you might make. See, suppose you are a creative thinker and, you know, you probably think of a creative idea drinking a cup of tea, okay, quietly in your house, in your study room. Okay, I'm not actually talking about that. I'm talking about developing creativity in students. How do you create an atmosphere? How do you change your courses? How do you modify, what are the critical elements that you should, see, it is about creating, what you said rightly, sir, is it is about the environment that that creates, nurtures creativity. So we have to create this environment for the students. Okay, we have to create this vibrant environment in the lab by, first of all, we should be enthusiastic. Okay, and it is, enthusiasm is, you know, it is contagious. If you are enthusiastic, others are also enthusiastic. Okay, and that's how, so it's about creating that environment to make people think creatively. Okay, so that is very important. That is the message that I wanted to give. Any other questions that we have? Nobody has any creative questions? Yeah, okay, thanks.